Today's spoiler video is brought to you by Card Kingdom. Use the link below to pre-order your cards today. Hello everyone, it's Seth, probably better known as Saffron Olive, and it's time for another daily dose of Commander 2020 spoilers. And I know we just had an Ikoria spoiler video, but so many spoilers today, with two sets being previewed all at once in like a 1 week time. So many cards that split off Commander, doing its own video on them. So let's talk some sweet new Commander 2020 cards, starting with a couple of our exclusive MTGGoldfish preview cards, thanks to Richard, Kalsian the Plague, and Shiny Impetus. So these are cards that Tomer did a full spoiler article and video on, which I will link in the description if you want a full breakdown. So not going to go super in-depth on them since Tomer covered it. Shiny Impetus, meh, I think it's unplayable. But it's one of those cards that kind of fills out the set. Kalsian, on the other hand, is a new commander. Mardu commander, 3 mana, 2/2, vigilance and haste, gets +1/+1 for each experience counter you have, which, worth noting, it does give itself experience counters, but if you have experience counters in other ways, those cross over too, so that's one way to grow your Kalsian. Then Kalsian can tap to deal a damage to a creature you don't control, and when that creature dies, you get an experience counter. So obviously, the idea with Kalsian is you play it, you ping stuff, you grow it, you make it big, sniping it down with your arrows. That's the plan of Kalsian. The problem is, one damage just doesn't kill much of anything in Commander. Maybe you could pick off like a random mana dork, but really, most Commander creatures are much bigger than that. So how do you build around Kalsian? I got a couple of ideas. First off, the evergreen way. If you're playing a Kalsian deck, what you gotta do is give Kalsian Death Touch. Bacillus Collar, Archetype of Finality, Gift of Doom. I don't care how you do it, but Kalsian needs to have Death Touch. If you can give Kalsian Death Touch, then all of a sudden that one tiny ping of damage, which is relatively useless in Commander, becomes incredibly useful because that ping takes down any single creature on the battlefield while also growing your Kalsian into an even bigger threat. So Death Touch, number one way to build around Kalsian. The other kind of janky fun way to build a Kalsian deck, which I'm sure I'll do eventually on Commander Clash, is go pinging tribal. Because we're in red and black, we get Cunning Spark Mazes and Kumbaj Witches and Prodigal Pyromancers, a ton of pinging stuff, which I don't think this would be a super effective strategy, but this is the perfect leader. Kalsian is the commander for pinging.deck, and we do have a lot of pingers in the format. With the power of a bunch of pingers combined, then all of a sudden, even without Death Touch, we're able to take down big creatures by tapping all of our pingers going at the same creature. Plus, with stuff like the archetype we talked about, giving all of our pingers Death Touch is incredibly scary because we can just repeatedly shoot down the board, eventually kill our opponent somehow. So that's Kalsian the Plague, new commander coming soon. Thanks again to Wizards for hooking us up with the spoiler, and check out Tomer's article on the new commander and also Shiny Impetus if you care about that sort of thing. Other than Kalsian, we got a bunch more commanders, including the return of the bad partner mechanic. I don't think it's bad, really, but compared to the original partners, where you could partner with anything that had partner, the new type of partner, where you can only partner with the partner, one specific card, is definitely less powerful, but I think that's a good thing, because the original partners were broken. So we have two sets of new partners, Kazer and Yukami. This is our Sultai pair of partners, and then Shabraz and Braylon, which is a Jeskai partner pair. So Kazer and Yukami, this is kind of a put counters on your creatures and then make your Yukami big to kill your opponent. Yukami is a 3-mana 2/2 that can't be blocked, and then when it leaves the battlefield, so that means dies or blinked, it deals X damage to target player and you gain X life, where X is its power. Kazer, on the other hand, lets your creatures grow as they deal combat damage. So the idea is you get bound both your commanders, you can keep getting in with Yukami, make it big, flicker it, have it die, whatever, deal a bunch of damage, gain a bunch of life. On the other hand, Shabraz and Braylon, this is a weird one. This, to me, it seems a little Game of Thrones, but with sharks thrown in somehow. That's how I see these. Shabraz is a flying shark. Braylon rides on the flying shark. Shabraz, whenever you draw a card, you get to put a counter on it and gain a life, and you can give a human flying. Braylon, which is a human, grows when you discard a card and deals a damage to your opponents, and you can give a shark trample, so they do synergize well together. It's weird creature types. We really don't have many sharks in Magic. Actually, before Ikoria and Commander 2020, we had zero sharks. Even cards that literally had shark in their name were fish. So this is a brand new creature type. So I don't know how many sharks there will be for Braylon to pump. But if you want to build flying shark tribal Game of Thrones shark dot deck, I don't even know. This is a partner pair to do it. So really, I don't think either of these partner pairs are especially powerful, but they have cool creature types. You can do different things, supporting tribes that just really haven't had support before. So they do have a use, but if you're just trying to do powerful things, I probably wouldn't go with either of these partner pairs. However, there are some commanders in Commander 2020 that I do think are pretty powerful, like Zixara the Exemplary. So this is a new Salti Nightmare Hydra legend. 4 mana 2/3 with Death Touch, taps for 2 mana, which that's already nice. Also has sweet R. And whenever you cast an X spell, a spell with X in its cost, you get a 0/0 green Hydra creature token and put X +1/+1 counters on it. So this is interesting for one really big reason. Traditionally in Magic, Hydras have been in primarily green, secondarily red. Blue is a relatively new addition with Hydroid Crosius, Bryoessence Hydra. So Zaraxa gives you a Hydra commander that includes these Hydras that just have not had support before. This also means, since it doesn't have red, that you're missing out on some powerful Hydras and support cards. Like Roshin Mander, that's one of the best X support cards. Just tapping to add 4 mana for X spells, you can't play that in your Zaraxa deck because it's in the wrong colors. Fix high-bedded mana wizards. Please do it. Do it now. You also don't get Apoculus Hydra, Urush the Hate Seed. So Zaraxa is kind of weird as a Hydra commander. Yes, you get Hydroid Crosses, Bioessence Hydra, but you miss out on a lot of really good Hydra. So I don't know if Hydra is the direction to go with this. On the other hand, where I do think this commander is really sweet is as an X-Spell commander. And if you're going the X-Spell route, you get Doubling Seasons, Unbound Flourishing, Primal Vigor to make your X-Spells even bigger, also make bigger tokens with your Zaraxa. So I imagine what you want to do with this is just play all your villainous wells, exsanguinates any big X spells possible, cast those for as much mana as possible, using Zaraxa as a way to make a bunch of mana, make some big Hydra tokens, and go to town that way. So, really unique commander. I like the uniqueness of it, adding a Hydra commander in blue, and also adding a different style of X payoff commander, which I think is really cool and really unique, and I'm really excited to build around Zaraxa. We also got Tiyama Luminous Enigma. So this is a weird one. This is an Abzan legend, a nightmare beast, 4 mana for a 3/3. Each other creature you control enters the battlefield with an additional vigilance counter. So basically, as long as you got Tiyama on the battlefield, all your creatures are going to have vigilance as they come into play. And then you could pay 3, remove 3 counters from among creatures you control to put the top 3 cards of your library into the graveyard, then return a permanent with converted mana cost 3 or less from your graveyard to the battlefield. There's some nice symmetry in this card. 3 mana, 3 counters, 3 cards, converted mana cost 3 less on a 3/3. If only it cost 3 mana, the card would be absolutely perfect. So close, Wizard. So Tiyama, when you read this, it doesn't read all that powerful. The ability's expensive. You're removing counters from your creatures, which normally you want counters on your creatures. Like, Tiyama gives your creatures vigilance as a benefit. +1/+1 counters are a benefit. However, there are a few mechanics in specific that actively want you to remove counters from your creatures, and I think that's the easiest way to go with Tiyama. So, for example, my first thought was Undying and Persist. Undying and Persist are mechanics that allow your creatures to come back into play when they die if they don't have a counter on them. So Giraffe's Messengers, Puppeteer Clip, Woodfall Primus, these are really powerful creatures with strong Enter the Battlefield abilities that you could use twice normally. But let's say you Puppeteer Click, steal one of your opponent's creatures, bash in for some damage, it dies, maybe you sacrifice it, comes back into play, you get to steal it again. Normally, the next time your Puppeteer Click dies, it's gone forever. Same with Woodfall Primus, whatever. Tiyama lets you remove the counter, though, which kind of makes your Puppeteer Click, Woodfall Primus infinite as you're going along, plus you're getting that value out of your Tiama. So Undying and Persist, number one way to build around Tiama. Number two is Vanishing. So Vanishing, this is kind of a weird way to build around it, but the best example of this is Lost Oromancers. Lost Oromancers, 4-mana 3-3, comes into play with 3 Vanishing counters, and when the last one is removed, you gotta sacrifice the creature. So normally it sits out, you gotta wait a turn, remove one on your upkeep, wait a turn, remove one on your upkeep, and then when Lost Oromancers dies, if it had no counters on it, you get to search your library for an enchantment, put it directly into play, which is incredibly powerful. The problem is, you gotta wait those turns normally. You're waiting for those counters to come off, and if your opponent kills it before the last counter comes off, you get nothing. You just played a Hill Giant. Well, Tiama just naturally removes those 3 counters. So you have down Tiama, you play Lost Oromancer, you pay 3 mana for Tiama, the counters go away, Lost Oromancer sacrifices itself, no counters on it, and that means you can grab whatever, Overwhelming Splendor, Sandworm Convergence, some massive, really powerful enchantment, put it directly onto the battlefield. Deadwood Tree Folk, you can speed up the reanimation of a creature. So number two, Vanishing. Number three, you can go kind of deep with cumulative upkeep cost. So cumulative upkeep, slowly adds counters to your creature, makes you pay mana or do something annoying, but Tiama can help keep that in check, like Sustaining Spirit. If it's on the battlefield, any damage it would reduce your life to less than 1 reduces it to 1 instead. You get a worship on a body. The problem is, the first turn after it's in play, you gotta pay 2 mana. The next turn, 4 mana. Next turn, 6 mana. Well, Tiama can help keep that cumulative upkeep in check by removing the cumulative upkeep counters. So number 3 is cumulative upkeep shenanigans. And honestly, none of these ways to build around Tiama are broken. The most powerful is probably Persist and Undying, but that does give you a good example of some of the shenanigans you can do with this cool new commander, which just didn't really exist before. There are ways to remove counters off of things, but not in the command zone. So really spicy new commander with some really cool build around elements in Tiama Luminous Enigma. Next up, we get Flawless Maneuver, which is just a good card. 3 mana, instant. If you control a commander, you can play it without playing its mana cost. Creatures you control gain indestructible until end of turn. So this is basically a way to protect your creatures. Unbreakable Formation, very similar, except it's always going to be 3 mana, and sometimes it'd pump your creatures, but it's mostly played to give your team indestructible, like Fizzle a Wrath, Fizzle a Removal spell. Flawless Maneuvers is kind of just a strict upgrade, I would say. Not strictly better, but I think in most decks, you would rather be able to play this for free while you're tapped out than get the +1/+1 counters, and Unbreakable Formation is pretty heavily played. I would consider it a staple of white-based aggressive decks in Commander, which means if you are playing Leiden, Hactos, Odric, any white creature aggro deck, Flawless Maneuver is very close to just an auto-include in those decks. You can use all of your mana to tap out for your commander, to tap out for your sweet threats, to pressure your opponent, and if your opponent is going to try to Wrath and blow you out, making it hard for you to recover because you're a white deck that doesn't have good cards and you can't draw cards, Flawless Maneuver could save the day. So I think Flawless Maneuver, like most free spells in Magic, has a lot of potential and will see a lot of play in white aggro decks and Commander. We also got Netherborn Altar, 2 mana artifact. Tap it, put a soul counter on it, put your commander into your hand from the command zone, and then you lose 3 life for each soul counter on it. So Netherborn Altar can be good in almost any deck because it's a way to get around the commander attacks. Once your commander is costing like 6 extra mana, paying 3 life to put it in your hand and be able to cast it without the commander attacks, that's worth it with most commanders. So that's the nice upside of Netherborn Altar. However, it's especially sweet with a couple of commanders that are really hard to build around. Phage the Untouchable, Hakan Stromgold Scourge. So Phage, if it comes into play and it wasn't from your hand, you lose the game. On the other hand, if you get it on the battlefield and hit your opponent, they lose the game. So Phage, basically unplayable, because if you cast it from the command zone and it comes into play, game over. Netherborn Altar gives you a way to not just get Phage back into your hand once, but to do it again and again and again. So this is one of the most important cards to building a Phage deck. Hakan is similar. You can only play it from your graveyard, but then once Hakan is in play from your graveyard, you can cast Knights from your graveyard, which is really powerful. Netherborn Altar gives you a way to get your Hakan into your hand, and then from your hand, it's easy enough to discard it to whatever and get it in the graveyard, go off with Hakan. So Netherborn Altar, I think it is something that's in consideration for decks where your commander is very important and your commander dies often. If you're playing a commander that's going to draw a lot of hate and you expect your opponents to keep killing it, I think that Netherborn Altar is worth considering because in the late game, it's going to be huge. Even if you use it once or twice, to get your commander back, get it into play on the cheap, that is a massive deal. And it's also one of the most important cards to making some of those weird commanders like Phage and Hakon actually work in the format. Next on our list, we get Curious Herd 4 mana instant. You choose an opponent and you create X33 beast creature tokens, where X is the number of artifacts that player controls. So basically, a massive board of beasts at instant speed if your opponent is playing a bunch of artifacts. So Curious Herd kind of compares to Dockside Extortionist. Yes, it's a watered-down version. You only get it from one opponent rather than all opponents. But still, Commander is a format where people are playing tons of Mana Rocks, Signets, Soul Rings, Smothering Tithe is a staple that makes a ton of artifacts. So Curious Herd is likely, in most games of Commander, if you get the timing right, going to make 3, 4, 5 tokens, and if you're lucky, you might even just go all out and get like 10 tokens and untap, play some sort of overrun or Triumph of the Horde, one shot kill your opponent. So I think Curious Herd is really interesting. It is a little risky. There will be games when it gets stuck in your hand, but the upside of getting 12 power, 15 power at instant speed for 4 mana means that it's definitely in the conversation for a bunch of different decks, especially decks that want to be overrunning, playing those other pump effects, Craterhoof Behemoth, stuff like that to help finish off the game. And if you have an artifact player in your playgroup that's just going to town with artifacts, then this card becomes absolutely bonkers, and I would highly recommend it in your decks. We also got Molten Echoes, 4 mana enchantment. When it comes into play, you choose a creature type, and whenever a non-token creature of that type enters the battlefield, you get to make a token copy of it that goes away at the end of the turn, also gains haste. So Molten Echoes is the next enchantment in a trifecta of enchantments. We also have Flame Shadow Conjuring, very similar, works with any non-token creature, except you gotta pay a mana to activate it, and then Mirror March can potentially be even more tokens than either Flame Shadow Conjuring or Molten Echoes, but it's attached to coin flip, so sometimes you get nothing, sometimes you'll get 2 or 3 or 4 copies, or 10 copies if you flip insanely well. So Molten Echoes, I think, is actually a pretty powerful card for a couple of reasons. One is, because of how it's worded, it goes infinite with Felidar Guardian. So Felidar Guardian, you get down Molten Echoes, you name Cat, you play Felidar Guardian. The Felidar Guardian copy comes into play, can blink the original, which is going to be another Cat coming into play, which will trigger Molten Echoes, which can make a Felidar Guardian, which will blink the original, on and on and on, until you have an infinite number of hasty Felidar Guardians and kill the table. So the copycat combo, one way to play with Molten Echoes. The other way to take advantage of this is play in a tribal deck with good Enter the Battlefield ability. So Molten Echoes, maybe you're playing Anala. Wizards have tons of awesome Enter the Battlefield abilities. Molten Echoes is naturally going to provide a lot of value there. Maybe you're playing Reaper King Scarecrows and want to double up your destructive effects of Reaper King, blowing up a ton of permanents. Playing Molten Echoes, naming Scarecrow, gonna be insane. Maybe you're playing Elementals with Risen Reefs and Omnas. Molten Echoes gonna be great in a deck like that as well. So if you're playing a tribe that has a lot of Enter the Battlefield triggers, and you're in red, of course, because you gotta be in the right color combination, then I think Molten Echoes is pretty close to an auto-include. So basically, not every deck can take advantage of it. You do need a decent number of creatures of the same creature type, or to have some sort of specific combo like copycat. In those decks, Molten Echoes provides a ton of free value, like a Mirror March, except you don't have to worry about being like me and just being horrible at flipping coins and getting no value out of it. Next on our list, we got Nascent Metamorph, the cutest little 2-mana shapeshifter. So 2-mana 1/1, but whenever it attacks or blocks, target opponent reveals cards from the top of their library till they reveal a creature, and it becomes a copy of it until end of turn. So the upside of this card is it can turn into something really scary and really massive, but it can also turn into something equally harmless, like a mana dork or something. So Nascent Metamorph, I think it's just a fun card. I'm not sure what deck would play this unironically, let's say, although it is one of the cards that we've seen from Commander 2020 so far that I'm at least a tiny bit interested in playing in Legacy. And I know this probably isn't actually going to be good enough because Legacy, you don't have that many sideboard slots, but there are Legacy decks where the only creatures in the deck are Emrakuls and Grizzlebrands. So against those decks, if you play this on turn 2 in attack, like against Reanimator or Sneak and Show, you know that you're going to be turning into a 15-15 Eldrazi, a Grizzlebrand that could draw you whole bunch of cards. So I think it's hilarious sideboard tech against these like reanimator or sneak and show strategies, but in reality, I think it's unlikely that you can actually dedicate sideboard slots to Nascent Metamorph. Instead, I think this is just a fun card to play in Commander. You play it, you attack with it on turn 3, cross your fingers that your opponent has something massive on the top of their deck, and you just absolutely blow them out. Is it going to work consistently? No. Is it really going to be a good card in Commander? I doubt it, but it is fun and random, and it'll do fun, flashy things, which is a lot of what the Commander format's about. We also got Heavenly Whale, and speaking of Legacy and Commander 2020 cards that might see play in Legacy, Heavenly Whale is on my list. So 6 mana 3/3, but it has Delve. You get a flyer, and when it attacks, you can put an instant or sorcery that you exiled with Heavenly Whale when you delved into play into your hand. So Heavenly Whale, when you think about Delve cards in Legacy, Dig Through Time, Treasure Cruise are the main blue ones, both banned in the format. We have seen cards like Gurmag Angler see a lot of play, Hooting Mandrel see a lot of play. Basically, Delve is busted in the Legacy format because you got cheap cantrips, you got a ton of fetch lands. It's really incidental to get four cards in your graveyard and have a Heavenly Whale coming down on turn two, and then you're getting essentially like a Sierra Avenger, which at one point was a Legacy playable creature, kind of like a Flip Delver of Secrets, better than a Flip Delver of Secrets for two mana. That, if you can exile a Brainstorm or a Force of Will or a Ponder or a Swords to Plowshare, is going to slowly put them back in your hand. And the cool thing about this is I imagine the deck that'll want to play Heavenly Whale is probably some sort of like Delvery tempo deck. In that deck, what you want to do is stick a early evasive threat, like Delver of Secrets, like Heavenly Whale, and then you want to protect that threat, tempo your opponent out, play some cheap counter spells, your dazes, your Force of Wills, cantrip to find more protection. Until your opponent dies, Heavenly Whale allows you to snowball that plan. You can get back the Brainstorm that you played on turn one, the daze that you countered something with early in the game, the Force of Will that you stopped your opponent combo piece with. Then you get back that Force of Will. That's another protection spell for your Heavenly Whale, which lets you attack again to get back another Force of Will, another cantrip to find a Force of Will. So I actually think that some sort of Delver shell in Legacy could take advantage of this. The only downside is 3 toughness does mean it's in Lightning Bolt range. That is kind of a risky number for Legacy, but still, I think the upside is there, and I think people at the very least will try this. And Commander, it's fine as well. Getting back spells from your graveyard is sweet, but more excited about this one for Legacy. We also got Aeon Frolicker, which is just a weird card. I don't even know what's going on with this card. 4 mana, 5/5 Elemental Otter. So not every Elemental Otter is bannable in Commander. When Aeon Frolicker enters the battlefield, if you cast it, target opponent takes an extra turn. So you can't give yourself an extra turn. You give your opponent an extra turn. But until your next turn, you and Planeswalkers you control get protection from that player. So essentially, you get a 4 mana 5/5. You get to choose an opponent to take an extra turn, but they can't really hurt you during that turn. So this is kind of like a mixture of a really bad Teferi's protection from one player with a strange political card. I guess I could see some upside to the politics of it. That's probably the main home from this. I can't see how this card is good, really, but it is really funny that if you have an opponent that builds a big board state, maybe you can team up and be like, all right, I will give you an extra turn if you attack this person, get him out of the game, or something like that. So really interesting politics shenanigans. Some amount of a protection ability, an okay body. I don't know. Definitely a weird creature. My guess is this is your Feldegraf, a political style card, in addition to those decks, but not something you would play fairly outside of decks where you're really dedicated to winning the game by granting political favors to your opponents and trying to parlay that into victory. We also got Mind Leecher, 6 mana, 5/5, mutates for 5. When it mutates, you get to exile the top card of each opponent's library, and you can look at and play those cards for as long as they remain exiled. So Mind Leecher, another card that I don't think you'll play in most decks, but if you're playing a deck built around winning with your opponent's cards, Gonti, Lord of Luxury, Send Triplets, maybe Jaleva, these decks are definitely going to want Mind Leecher because you want basically anything that can steal and allow you to play your opponent's cards. Mind Leecher gives you a big flying body. You mutate it, you steal those cards. Who knows what you'll get, but that's fine. That's what your deck is about, stealing your opponent's stuff and turning it against them. We also got Boneyard Mycodrax, and this card's pretty interesting. 3-mana Star-Star. Its power and toughness are equal to the number of other creature cards in your graveyard, and then you can scavenge it for 5-mana. Exile from the graveyard, and you put a number of +1/+1 counters on a creature equal to Boneyard Mycodrax's power. So this card, it can be pretty big in a dedicated graveyard deck. The first thing I thought of is decks like Jerad, Veral's straight up Scavenge Commander, Izoni. If your deck that's built around getting a lot of creatures in your graveyard and then using that to value, Boneyard Mycodrax, really easy inclusion. It's going to be massive in your deck. You just cast it, it's huge. And then you even get some one-shot kill potential. If you can get this in your graveyard with 10 other creatures, or I guess even 9 other creatures, you can just scavenge it onto like an Ink Moth Nexus, a Plague Stinger, maybe even your commander in the right circumstance, in one-shot kill an opponent with the amount of counters that Boneyard Mycodrax is putting on it. So you got to be a dedicated graveyard deck. But in that deck, the fungus offers a good body and some interesting one-shot kill backup plan potential. We also got Nesting Ground. So Nesting Ground, colorless land, you can pay one, move a counter from target permanent you control onto another target permanent, only do it as a sorcery. So Nesting Grounds, it fits in one very specific place. I don't think you want to play this to move around +1/+1 counters, move around ability counters, things like that. What you do with Nesting Ground is you play it in Super Friends. If you're playing a Super Friends deck, this is a great card in your deck because you can remove loyalty counters from one Planeswalker that maybe doesn't need that much loyalty, your random Garrick, and put it on your Nicol Bolas, let's say, to get it towards its ultimate. Whatever Planeswalker you're closest to ultimating, this is basically remove a loyalty counter from a Planeswalker I don't care about to get closer to ultimating a Planeswalker I do care about. So in Super Friends, Nesting Ground is great. Otherwise, I don't think you want to play it in any other deck. Maybe you could do funny things with the new mechanic counters, like, I moved my Death Touch counter onto the creature you're blocking, I got you. But really, to me, this looks like a Super Friends card. Otherwise, we get a few other rares, not going to go into them super in-depth because I don't think they're that great or that interesting. Ravenous Gigantotherium. Kind of a green wrath. Decoy Gambit, 3-mana instant. For each opponent, you choose up to one creature they control. Then you either bounce that creature or they let you draw a card. So Decoy Gambit, I don't feel like it really does enough. It's kind of like this soft bounce spell. Best case scenario is you draw 3 for 3, which is painful truce. That's not that exciting. And your opponent gets to make the choice. Maybe there's like some politicking that you could do with it. But I'm really stretching. I think Decoy Gambit, mostly unplayable. Speaking of unplayable, Sanctuary Blade equips, gets protection, not very exciting. I mean, we're in a format with swords and so many powerful equipment. I don't think even dedicated equipment decks would stoop so low that they need to play Sanctuary Blade. Otherwise, Wartime Broker, helps you get in combat damage. I guess that's fine. Obscuring Haze, actually a pretty powerful card. Apparently the cast it for free if you have a commander cards are a cycle. The green one is like a super fog. If you have your commander, you can cast it for free. Otherwise, it's a 3-mana instant, and you prevent all damage that we've dealt this turn by your opponent's creatures, which is really, really key. When I first read this, I thought it was a free fog, and I was like, okay, that's fine. Like, maybe I'd play that. But the fact that it only prevents the damage of your opponent's creatures means you can be tapped out, you can swing into your opponent's team, or they swing into your team, you make blocks, and then cast this, wipe out your opponent's creatures, all your stuff survives because the damage is prevented from your opponent's creatures, and kind of just get like a million for one. So because it's way better than an actual fog, I actually kind of like Obscuring Haze. Anyway, I think that brings us to the end of our daily Commander 2020 spoilers for today. So what do you think about these cards, the new partner commanders, our exclusive preview cards? Thanks again to Wizards for that. All the new random support cards, moving counters around, human, menacing, free spells. What of these cards are you most excited about? What are you going to do with them in Commander? What decks are you going to build? What do you think of Commander 2020 now that we're fully into spoiler season? Let me know in the comments. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed it, and I will talk to you soon. Thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed it, help us out by clicking that like button down below. And to keep up on all the latest and greatest, click that subscribe button. And don't forget to hit that bell icon to get alerts whenever we have new videos. And if you want to, check out some of our other sweet videos here and here.